You're listening to the audio production of Seven Women and the Secret of Their Greatness by Eric Metaxas, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Tom Parks. For Suzanne. Introduction. Before I wrote this book, I wrote two long biographies, one about Dietrich Bonhoeffer and one about William Wilberforce. I was overwhelmed at the response to these books. It was clear that these stories had deeply impacted and inspired many readers. And though I knew the stories of many other extraordinary and inspiring figures, I didn't plan to write any more long biographies. But then I realized that I could write shorter ones, and so I wrote Seven Men. The response to this book was also beyond what I had expected or hoped, and further confirmed my belief that there is a great hunger for heroes in our culture. Although I was never sure whether I would write a book that included the biographies of seven women, people kept asking me about it, and the more I thought about it, the more I knew that I must do it. I've always admired the women in this book and realized that many people didn't know their stories. To be clear, in neither Seven Men nor this book is the list of seven persons in any way definitive. There are many other inspiring men and women I might have included. For each book, I simply chose seven people whose stories I found most compelling and inspiring. And there's no doubt that the stories of the seven great women in this book are hugely inspiring, and not just to women. I hope men will listen to these stories and not deny themselves the inspiration of these truly extraordinary lives. For the many men whose view of women has been twisted and dented by our cultural assumptions, these lives will be inspiring and encouraging news. But whose stories should I tell? I began asking friends for suggestions and soliciting their thoughts. In doing so, I encountered an assumption about women's greatness that wasn't surprising, but that is worth mentioning here. Many people suggested women who were the first ones to do something that men had already done. Amelia Earhart, who was the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic in 1932, was mentioned, as was Sally Ride, who was the first American woman in space. No one mentioned Shirley Cha-Cha Muldowney, who was the first female Top Fuel dragster champion, but I'm sure she would have come up eventually. But what these women had accomplished didn't exemplify the kind of greatness I had in mind, neither for men nor women. If it had, in writing Seven Men, I would have replaced Wilberforce and Bonhoeffer with John Glenn and Charles Lindbergh, and might have replaced Pope John Paul II with Don Big Daddy Garlitz, or perhaps even Don the Snake Prudhomme, two of the greatest drag racers in history. What struck me as wrong about these suggestions was that they presumed women should somehow be compared to men. But it seemed wrong to view great women in that way. The great men in Seven Men were not measured against women, so why should the women in Seven Women be measured against men? I wondered what was behind this way of seeing things, that women should be defined against men, or that men and women should even be compared to each other. Two interrelated attitudes seemed at play. First, men and women are in some ways interchangeable, that what one does, the other should do. Second, women are in some kind of competition with men, and for women to progress, they need to compete with men. This thinking pretends to put men and women on equal footing, but it actually only pits them against each other in a kind of zero-sum competition, in which they usually tear each other down. When I consider the seven women I chose, I see that most of them were great for reasons that derive precisely from their being women, not in spite of it. And what made them great has nothing to do with their being measured against or competing with men. In other words, their accomplishments are not gender neutral, but are rooted in their singularity as women. All of them existed and thrived as women, and stand quite apart from anything touching the kind of thinking I encountered. The first woman I chose, Joan of Arc, is a good example. She is sometimes thought of as great because she did what men do. She donned armor and became a warrior. But that is far off the mark. Joan of Arc was no fierce Amazon. Far from it. there was nothing even slightly manly about her. On the contrary, it was her youth, innocence, purity, and holiness that made it possible for her to do what she did. Only just past girlhood, she was deeply affected by the suffering she saw in the battles around her, never becoming inured to the carnage and agonies of war as a male soldier typically will do. It was precisely her vulnerability and womanly virtue that stunned and inspired the rough soldiers in a way that no man ever could do. It was because of these qualities that they were in awe of her and respected her. Though her spirit was as large as anyone's who has ever lived, she herself was neither big nor strong. In other words, there could never be a male Joan of Arc. The very idea is a laughable oxymoron. Similarly, Rosa Parks was specifically chosen to do what she did because she was a woman. Those who wanted to make a federal case out of her arrest knew they must have the right person, and they knew it must be a woman. Her feminine dignity was vital to the case, so there never could have been a male Rosa Parks. Obviously, Susanna Wesley, who bore 19 children and raised the surviving 10, could not have been a man. And St. Maria of Paris wanted to be a mother to all she encountered and positively exuded motherhood. Hannah More was considered a model of femininity by those who knew her, and because of this, she was especially valued and respected by the many men whom she called friends. She was nothing like their male friends, and so the cultural influence she wielded was not a result of her being one of the boys. Quite the contrary. Corrie ten Boom exudes an unmistakably feminine warmth, and who can doubt that it was Mother Teresa's femaleness that flummoxed and disarmed and charmed those with whom she dealt? Can we as easily imagine a man doing what she did? So the stories of these great women show us that men and women are not interchangeable. There are things men can and should do that women cannot, and there are things that women can and should do that men cannot. So comparing men and women is something like comparing apples and oranges, except apples and oranges are actually far more like each other than are men and women. Apples and oranges can exist without each other, but men and women cannot. Men and women were deliberately designed to be different. Indeed, we are specifically created as complements to each other, as different halves of a whole, and that whole reflects the glory of God. It's patently obvious that we were physically created to fit together. And of course, if that weren't the case, we could not create life. So when men cease to be such, or when women deny their uniqueness, they make that complementarity impossible, and the whole, as it were, suffers. There's much to be said on that subject, but the point to make here is that we are meant to be different, and God wants us to celebrate and rejoice in our differences, never to suppress them or denigrate them. I'm privileged to be friends with someone whose husband was born in 1889. For context, that's the year Vincent van Gogh painted Starry Night, Jefferson Davis died, and Adolf Hitler was born. Alice von Hildebrand, her friends call her Lily, is a delight. So much so that I've now twice had her as my guest at Socrates in the City, a forum that encourages busy and successful professionals in thinking about the bigger questions in life. Her age, 91 as I write this, gives her a great measure of authority, but it hasn't dimmed her fire even slightly. It would not be inaccurate to describe her as a pistol. I mention her now because she has written two books that deal with the issue of men and women. One is The Privilege of Being a Woman, and the other is Man and Woman, a Divine Intervention. As she fiercely declared in my most recent interview with her, she is tremendously pro-woman, and she was that evening we spoke, but she also makes it abundantly clear that it is precisely for this reason that she is a devoted and lifelong opponent of feminism. She firmly believes feminism to be anti-woman because it pressures women to become more like men. Everyone who heard her speak that evening was surprised, but we were sternly schooled by Dame von Hildebrand on this subject. The lesson in all this is that to pit women against men is a form of denigration of women, as though their measure must be determined by masculine standards. The worst standards of masculine value, power usually at the top of those long lists, become the very things that some women are told they must aspire to meet. How ironic that modern culture, by so often intimating power as the highest good, should force women to accept what amounts to nothing less than patriarchal thinking, in the most pejorative sense of that adjective. Of course, this is entirely understandable. Some men have misused their power and strength to harm women. As I say in the introduction to Seven Men, whatever God gives us is meant for us to use to bless others. And God gives men strength and power, generally speaking, only so they will use it to bless those who do not have it. But when men fail to do so, women who are victims of the worst expressions of manhood, in fact, abrogations of real manhood, feel that the only way to deal with this is to wrest that power from men. So the idea of female empowerment arose until it became another ubiquitous and thought-free cliché. But the problem with this idea is that it presupposes the tremendously harmful and distorting idea of a competition for power. That idea was famously popularized in 1973 in the so-called Battle of the Sexes, the much-heralded and nationally televised tennis match between Billie Jean King, a woman, and Bobby Riggs, a man. The cultural climate at the time was that there were two ways of seeing the world. One was the bigoted, male chauvinist pig way, and the other was the enlightened, I am woman, hear me roar way. In this scenario, women and men were pitted against each other as bitter adversaries, and the only way for women to lift themselves up was to denounce men as sexists and cavemen. Billie Jean King was then in her prime, 26 years younger than Bobby Riggs, who had been a tennis champion in the 1940s. That she prevailed was no great surprise to anyone paying attention, but the way the match was publicized made it out to be an epical event. The most important and terrible thing was that it portrayed the relationship between men and women as a zero-sum game. If one won, the other lost. In this view of the relationship between the sexes, there can be no equity, no mutual admiration, no mutual encouragement, and of course, no real love. That night, it was this view writ large. The only way for one to win was for the other to lose. It made for great television ratings, but this idea is a pernicious lie, one that has hurt men and women terribly. Whether we like it or not, men and women are inextricably intertwined. Because the Bible says that we are made in God's image, male and female He created them, Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, the fortunes of one are so linked to the fortunes of the other that there is no way to lift one without lifting the other, and no way to degrade one without degrading the other. So whenever men have used their positions of authority or their power to denigrate women, they have denigrated themselves and have denied themselves the fullness of manhood God intended for them. When women have tried to ape the behavior of power-hungry men, they have degraded themselves and denied themselves the dignity of being above that vulgar fray. It is all the more noteworthy that the great women in this volume stood on their own as women, but not in a defiant stance that pitted them against men. On the contrary, they were large-hearted enough and secure enough in who they were to show remarkable magnanimity toward men, with whom they had notably warm relationships. Joan of Arc's relationships with the soldiers who served under her is nothing less than moving. Susanna Wesley's love for her sons and their reverence for her speak volumes. Hannah Moore's relationships with her four sisters were at the very heart of her life, but she also had a pronounced capacity for friendship with men, including David Garrick, Horace Walpole, Dr. Samuel Johnson, and William Wilberforce. Maria Skobetsova's, St. Maria of Paris, love for her son and relationship with Father Dmitri Klipinin tells us everything about her, as does Corrie ten Boom's relationship with her father. Mother Teresa's friendship with Pope John Paul II was well known, and it is clear that Rosa Parks' relationship with her husband was at the center of her life and accomplishments. Perhaps the best thing about biographies is that they enable us to slip the strictures of time and provide a bracing corrective to our tendency to see everything in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.